And also, let me start sharing. And this is the poem, Mending Wall. Really, here the poem I told you there is, I gave you, there is a good section here, the analysis of the poem. As you can see here, really, if I read briefly some of this, really, this poem, as you can see here, I say Robert Frost presents us to us the ideas of barriers between people, communication, friendship, and the sense of security people gain from barriers. You know, really, this is the main idea. The poem, of course, it has so many meanings, of course, and I'm saying here that these are some of the implications, symbolical implications that we can find in this poem. And here, really, the message, is that why do we need walls? Why do we need barriers between us? Notice his messages are conveyed using poetic techniques such as imagery, structure, and humor, revealing a complex side of the poem, as well as achieving an overall lighthearted effect. Robert Frost has cleverly intertwined both a literal and metaphoric meaning into the poem, using the mending of a tangible wall as a symbolic representation of the barriers that separate the neighbors in their friendship. So here I say, notice the theme of the poem is about two neighbors who disagree over the need of a wall to separate their properties. Not only does the wall act as a divider in separating estates, it also acts as a barrier in the neighbor's friendship, separating them. For the neighbor with the pine trees, the wall is of great significance, for example, as it provides a sense of security and privacy. He believes that although no two people can still be friendly neighbors, some form of barrier is needed to separate them and wall in the personal space and privacy of the individual. This is shown through his repeated saying, good fences make good neighbors. The neighbor's property is a representation of his privacy, as well as, and the wall acts, of course, as a barrier against intrusion. Here, I leave the rest for you. Please read that, because really it's, I gave you all this in a nice way. You read that, and I think it's clear. But let me read the poem with you, and if you want me to explain anything, I would. Notice, something there is that does not love a wall, that sends the frozen ground swell under it, that spills the upper boulders in the sun, and makes gaps even two can't pass abreast. The works of hunters is another thing. I have come after them and made repair. Where they have left not one stone on a stone, but they would have the rabbit out of hiding. To please the yelping dogs, the gaps I mean, no one has seen them made or heard them made. But at spring mending time, we find them there. I let my neighbor know beyond the hill, and on a day we meet to walk the line and set the wall between us once again. We keep the wall between us as we go, to each the boulders that have fallen to each. And some are loaves and some so nearly balls. We have to use a spell to make them balance. Stay where you are until our backs are turned. We wear our fingers rough with handling them. Oh, just another kind of outdoor game. On one on a side, it seems too little more. There where it is we do not need the wall. He is all pine and I am all and I am apple orchard. My apple trees will never get across and eat the cones under his pines, I tell him. He only says, good fences make good neighbors. Spring is the mischief in me, and I wonder if I could put a notion in his head. Why do they make good neighbors? Isn't it where there are cows? Isn't it where there are cows? But here there are no cows. Before I built a wall, I'd ask to know what I was walling in or walling out. And to whom I was like to give offense. Something there is that does not love a wall. That wants it down, I could say elves to him. But it's not elves exactly, and I'd rather he said it for himself. I see him there bringing a stone grasped firmly by the top, in each hand, like an old stone savage armed. He moves in darkness, as it seems to me, not of woods only and the shade of trees. He will not go beyond his father's saying, and he likes having thought of it so well. He says again, good fences make good neighbors. Yeah, so really this man here is wondering about his neighbor. He's saying, really, there's something I don't like about this wall. There is even something in nature which does not like this wall. Why do we like, why do we want this wall? He said, there's something which is turning, which is really all the time is tearing down this wall. Nature is turning it down. He said, the ground frozen, you know, it's swelling up and turning it down, spills it over. It means it's, nature is destroying it every year. And he's saying, you know, there are gaps, and who's doing this? We don't know. Hunters or rabbits or animals or elves or devils or cows or sheep or, you know, he's saying, we don't know. But he always says, we want to repair the wall and build the wall again between us. You know, and I think it's really interesting. And he goes on to say to him about, you know, I really don't like this wall, but he always says, no, I like this wall. And he said, you know, normally we have walls to separate, you know, fields or properties, because you are worried that maybe your, you know, animals or cows or sheep or dogs or horses or whatever may come and trespass into your land. But he said, we have nothing. We don't worry. You know, he said, my land is pine trees, and his land is, you know, apple trees, or, you know, my apple or his pines, the same. So there's nothing is going to be, you know, hurting each other. So he's saying, why do we need this wall? And his neighbor says, no, I want this wall. I want this wall because my father says, you know, he said, fences make good neighbors. And he will never change, you know, this idea, he said. Good fences make good neighbors. Yeah, what do you think? Do you agree? Hello? Do you agree that fences are needed, and fences are good because they keep privacy, and they give you a sense of security, they give you a sense of, yeah, could be. But really the poem here, the speaker is saying, really walls are barriers. We don't need barriers, and we don't need separators. We can live together, you know, happily, no problem. Why do we need walls? And he said, sometimes You know, if you are rolling in something or rolling out something, meaning wanting to protect your people from something, fine. And when you want to protect, you know, even yourselves from outside danger, yes, you know, in a way, this is okay. But he said, if there are no dangers, no need for, you know, this rolling in or rolling out, as if defending yourself or protecting yourself or whatever. Yeah, so really the idea here is quite interesting and symbolical. I think Robert Frost here is talking about really friendship and communication and the humanity and really nice ideas. I think here for example, if I read this notice, the poem itself is a technique Robert Frost uses to convey his ideas. Behind the literal representation of the building of walls, there's a deeper metaphoric meaning which reflects people's attitudes towards others. It reflects the social barrier between, you know, people or people really build to provide a sense of personal security and comfort in the belief that barriers are a source of protection which will make people less vulnerable to their fears. Robert Frost's ideas are communicated strongly through the perspective of the narrator in the poem, the I voice, who questions the need for barriers. The use of conversation in the and the thoughts of the narrator reflect the poem's own thoughts. In the line, for example, in line 30 to line 35, the narrator questions the purpose of a wall. He has an open, for example, disposition and does not really understand the need to wall in or wall out anything or anyone. Yeah, well, that's one of the ideas, okay? Now, as I said, I think this is very clear. I think there's a mistake should be here. Yeah. Okay. Just please read the whole thing, and that's enough, I think, for us here. For you, you can see all that clearly. Now, the last man to talk about, and really a great name for me to talk about, is Gibran Khalil Gibran. As I told you, Gibran is a great American, Lebanese American, if you like, poet, who is one of the real founders of one Arabic literature, trend, which is called really the literature of the immigrants, or the literature of the sometimes you call it diaspora, which is people like, as we say, al-Mahjar, really. Gibran really wrote a lot of metaphorical poetry and really symbolical poetry, and he wrote lovely short stories and fables, a lot of fables in reality, really. Here, the poems we have are also quite symbolical. Look at the word here, the title, the first poem called Love. Love. They say the jackal and the mole drink from the same stream, where the lion comes to drink. And they say the eagle and the vulture dig their beaks into the same carcass and are at peace one with the other in the presence of the dead thing. Of course, you can see here there's no rhyme. It's a free verse, kind of like unrhymed verse. Look at the symbolism, of course, and the metaphors here. They say the jackal and the mole drink from the self same stream, where the lion comes to drink. They say the eagle and the vulture dig their beaks into the same carcass and are at peace one with the other in the presence of the dead thing. Oh love, whose lordly hand has bridled my desires and raised my hunger and my thirst to dignity and pride. Let not the strong in me and the constant eat the bread and or drink the wine that tempt my weaker self. Let me rather starve and let my and let and let my heart parch with thirst, and let me die and perish ere I stretch my hand to a cup you did not fill or a bowl you did not bless. This poem is very, very symbolical, really symbolical. You know, when the title, you know, the title is addressed to love, you know, the meaning of love. Again, look at the symbolism that when those animals he's giving the first two stanzas, the jackal and the mole and the lion, they all agree, you know, this, the jackal, which is a very tiny, terrible, like, you know, like one of those foxes, small animals. And the mole, of course, is even this little even thing that lives under the ground. And sometimes it's really, sometimes people, I don't know if you've ever seen that or you've heard of that. It's the only animal that has no eyes, that has no eyes. And the mole is called the mole. He said, if the jackal and the mole, they drink from the same stream, and the lion, who is a giant, strong animal, they drink from the same spring, from the same stream. So they are equal in this way. They love each other, or they are happy with each other. No problem whether you are massive or strong or weak or tiny. Since we eat from the same thing, we drink from the same thing, so we should be equal and love each other. Again, he gives another example. The vulture and the eagle, you know, they eat from the same dead animal. Carcass means a dead body of an animal. And they say, you know, an eagle and a vulture, and, you know, like, if they eat from the same thing and they are in peace, they are happy to do that. So they are equal. No real problem. Now, as if to say, we people are not the same. We are crazy. We are funny. We lack this. You know, and that's why he said, "Oh, love, whose worldly hand has bridled my desires." You know, because of love, I'm being stopped. I'm being bridled. You know, to bridle means really to control, completely control yourself. You know, sometimes we use bridle for horses. If you have a big, really strong horse, you can't stop a horse or an elephant or a big animal. You need to stop it by using bridle, right? And he said, you know, he said, love really is the thing that stops me or stops our desire. And he said, my desire, and raised my hunger and my thirst to dignity and pride. You know, he's saying, because of love, I stop myself and I don't worry about, I suppress my hunger or my feelings or my bodily, my sexual, my selfish my terrible, my maybe hard desires, or maybe all those savage desires, and so on. And he's saying hunger and thirst, and he's saying to lift them to dignity and pride. Let not the strong in me and the constant eat the bread and drink the wine that tempt my weaker self. So you see here, he's saying, if I have all these selfish bodily desires, I want to suppress all these feelings and all these bodily drives. I have so many bodily selfish drives, egos, right? He's saying constant bread and drink and wine and all these things, I want to suppress them, to control them, to stop them. So tempt my weaker self. Okay? Let me rather starve, and let my heart parch with thirst, and let me die and perish. Here I stretch my hand to a cup you did not fill, or a bowl you did not bless. You know, the symbolism here is, if to say that I will not do anything unless is given through love. I will starve to death rather than take something which is not mine. Or, as he said, to a cup you did not fill, meaning through love, through real good feeling. Or to eat something which is not mine. Or a bowl here. Bowl means something to eat with or through, like a dish. You did not bless, meaning given to you because you deserve it, or given to you through the heavenly blessings. And you can see, as I say, really, this is, when you look at the title here, love, you know, it's very strange, symbolical title, love. So he's doing, and he's saying, I want everything to be done, to be given through this absolutely high, lovely, if you like, meaning, sublime meanings of love. I want to do things through heavenly implications of everything. So really, the poem here is very symbolical, as you can see, absolutely symbolical, allegorical. As I said, Gibran really did all this a lot in his poetry. Most of his writings, as I said, really full of symbolism and allegory and distant, hidden meanings. Okay? Look at the next one here. A tear and a smile. A tear and a smile. Again, look at the title, really is quite really symbolical. Dam'a wabtisama. Really, it's a lovely title. Dam'a wabtisama. You know, this is, you know, in Arabic, it's a lovely title. I would not exchange, he said, I would not exchange the sorrows of my heart for the joys of the multitude. And I would not have the tears that sadness makes to flow from my every part turn into laughter. I would not exchange the sorrows of my heart for the joys of the multitude. And I would not leave the tears that sadness makes to flow from my every part turn into laughter. I would that my life remain a tear and a smile. I would that I would that my life remain a tear and a smile. Again, really, is this is interesting, and you know, again, symbolical. Is he saying that he wants to cry, and at the same time, you know, to want to have always to cry and yet to smile? I would that means I want only, I want my life to be always to remain like that, with tear and a smile. And he explains this maybe, I a tear to purify my heart and give me understanding of life's secrets and hidden things. So that's, he is explaining, what do you mean by a tear? A tear to purify my heart and give my understanding of life's secrets and hidden things. So the tear means here to purify myself and to understand the existence of myself, to understand all the secrets of life, the hidden things of life, to understand the value of your creation, to understand the value, your value of your existence in this world, to understand your relationship to God. And when you understand the real relationship here, he said, you cry. You really have tear. And the tear here is to purify yourself. A smile to draw me nigh to the sons of my kind and to be a symbol of my glorification of the gods. Yeah, now he's using the word gods in the plural, in the mythological sense. He said, the smile, if I smile, then I will, you know, I will be human and people will be near me like everybody else. Again, to the sons of my kind. A smile to draw nigh, to draw near, to become very close to my neighbors, to my people, to my friends, to my fellow men, to my fellow creatures, human beings. And then to become symbolical to everybody, to symbolical, to glorify God. And, you know, he said here, God's really, he doesn't mean it in a real sense. Of course, he means it, of course, again, in the symbolical sense. And again, he said, he always using the word tear and smile, comparing and contrasting the two together all the time, the meanings and the symbolism, if you like. The constant symbolism and the many implications and interpretations of smile and tear. Again, he goes on, a tear to unite me with those of broken hearts. If I see sad people, I should cry with them. This would help them. I will be united with them through sharing with them their agonies or their pain. A tear to unite me with those of broken hearts. And again, a smile to be a sign of my joy in existence. You see, notice he is always contrasting, really is very lovely way of showing all this. I would rather that I died in yearning and longing than that I live weary and despairing. He said, I would rather die. I prefer death rather than to be in despair. I would rather die rather than being, he said, weary and despairing. Weary and despairing, meaning absolutely, you know, miserable and sad and tired and sick. You know, of course, you know, that's the idea. You need to prefer death. Again, this is, of course, to some extent, this is symbolical. I want the hunger for love and beauty to be in the depth and spirit. Sorry. I want the hunger for life. Sorry. I want the hunger for love and beauty to be in the depth of my spirit, for I have seen those who are satisfied, the most wretched of people. I have heard the sight of those in yearning and longing, and it's sweeter than the sweetest melody. You know, again, he's exaggerating, I think. Remember, as I said, again and again and again, really, Gibran is writing here a lot of allegory and a lot of symbolism. I want the hunger for love and beauty to be in the depth of my spirit, for I have seen those who are satisfied, the most wretched of people. Meaning, I know people who are really very sad and very poor and very miserable, and yet they are happy. They are very poor, but yet they are happy and they are satisfied. I know many people like that. I have heard the sigh of those in yearning and longing, and it is sweeter than the sweetest melody. I know people who are really very sad and very miserable and have nothing, but yet they are happy. Yet they are happy. In other words, don't complain. You know, just say, you are fine. Yeah, you are fine. Even he said, you are in a real terrible, you know, time maybe, but still, he said, still, notice, those, I have heard the sigh of those in yearning and longing, and yet it is sweeter than the sweetest melody. You know, sometimes I think, yeah, in a way, there are people who are happy, if you like, who would like to do all these things in their own, if you like, fashion, which is sometimes really strange. With evenings coming, the flower folds her petals and sleeps embracing longing. At morning's approach, she opens her lips to meet the sun's kiss. You know, again, really, he goes on. With evenings coming, the flower folds her petals and sleeps, embracing longing. At morning's approach, she opens her lips to meet the sun's kiss. You know, now he's comparing how the flower dies in the evening, and in the morning it opens again and smiles to the sun. You know, he's comparing how people should be like, you know, the symbolism. Like a flower. In the evening, a flower will sleep, he said, folds itself. With evening's coming, flower folds her petals, you know, meaning how a flower folds itself and sleeps, right? And even, you know, would wait and sleep at night. And in the morning, it opens up again. And I know flowers like that. I know I've seen so many things like that. That flower, really, it's amazing that in the evening they close, they sleep, and right at the beginning, right at the first hour of the day, they just open again in a lovely fashion, which is amazing. And he said, the life of a flower is longing and fulfillment. A tear and a smile. So our life is like that. In the evening, we feel sad, maybe if you are sad, but the next day, when the day comes and you have the sun and things are better, you should smile. In the evening, you feel sad, you cry, you are miserable, you are unhappy, but wait the next day for the morning. Wait in the next day, in the morning, you will be better. You'll be happier. And that's what it means here, right? The life of a flower is longing and fulfillment. It's the same thing, longing and fulfillment. How you long for something and how you fulfill yourself. You always want to have something. And life, he said, one day you feel you have a tear, the next day you have a smile. Don't worry. Life is not always smiles. Life is not always tears. One day you cry, the next day you smile. That's certain. And he goes on. The waters of the sea become vapor and rise and come together and area cloud. You know, yeah, he said, the water of the sea, he said, they changed from vapor and they rise up and they became cloud and then rain. And the cloud floats above the hills and valleys until it meets the gentle breeze, then falls weeping to the fields and joins with brooks and rivers and return to the sea, its home. You see, again, this is a lovely image here, comparing the water of the sea. It goes up in vapor and goes to become clouds, and then it rains, and then the water makes rivers and brooks, and then it comes back to the sea. So it's like a circle, really, it's like a cycle. And that's it, the water is always, you know, coming up from the sea and then coming back to the sea. And on its way, it did a good job. Really, that's what he means. The cloud floats above the hills and valleys until it meets the gentle breeze, then falls weeping to the fields and joins with brooks and rivers and return to the sea, its home. The life of clouds is a parting and a meeting. You see, this is again a lovely image. The life of a cloud is a parting and a meeting, a tear and a smile. Wow, it's really lovely. The life of a cloud, or the life of clouds, is a parting and a meeting. Notice the really contradiction or the paradox. Parting and then meeting. Parting and then meeting. That's it. A tear and then a smile. A tear and then a smile. And so does the spirit become separated from the greater spirit to move in the world of matter. Now he becomes talking to us people, to our bodies. He said, and so does the spirit become separated from the greater spirit. That is, your body has a spirit inside. And when you die, your spirit will go to heaven, he said. Will leave the matter. The matter is your body. The matter is your body, which will go back to earth. And so does the spirit become separated from the greater spirit to move in the world of matter and pass as a cloud over the mountains of sorrow and the plains of joy to meet the breeze of death and return whence it came. And return, you know, we say that really. We say, you know, our spirits go, and people say so many strange things sometimes. You say. He said, our spirits go back to God, he said. Notice, pass as a cloud over the mountain of sorrow and the plains of joy to meet the breeze of death and return whence it came. To the ocean of love and beauty, to God. We say that, you know, our spirits, he said, when we die, you know, we say this, that our spirits go back to God, as we say. I don't know if this is really, sometimes, you know, there's a lot of philosophical things about it, but here really, really here, Gibran is talking about life. He's talking about us. And he's using so many amazing images, really, to say, well, this is us. You know, if you ask yourself this heavy question about your position and your place in this world, you know, at the end of the day, our bodies will disintegrate into the earth, from earth to earth, as we say, from ashes to ashes. And our souls will go to, you know, to God, as, you know, Gibran is saying. But our bodies, you know, the body is made of ash or, you know, soil. And as we say, earth. And that's why, you know, the idea here that your spirit will go somewhere, you know. And the idea really here, he's saying this in a very amazing symbolical way. He said, our spirits will go to the oceans, to the ocean of God, to the ocean, of course, he said, ocean of love and beauty to God, symbolizing all this lovely, really amazing thing, which is, notice here the word love and beauty, capital letters, to mean, you know, God. And I think this is really amazing, powerful poem to accept, really to accept our life as it is, to accept destiny, to accept our position in this world, and to know that one day we will be happy, the next day we may not be happy, because that's life. That is life. That is life. Really, that's what he means here in the whole poem. Okay. Hello, hello, my people, are you there?
Doctor?
Yes, doctor, yeah.
Yeah?
Why the word return is capitalized?
The word?
Return.
Return. Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Because again, where is it? Which
line
yeah.
to the fields.
Return to the sea, its home. Really, because again, because to him the whole thing is the question of. Because this is a big question, we always say we return. You know, everything in this world is something to do with return. This is what we say, the cycle is going, you know, we are always moving in a cycle. So we are always returning, as if to say, as we say here, our bodies will return to earth and our souls will return to heaven. And this process of returning, recycling, and which is a permanent process of recycling. You know, the idea, really, he believes in this question of that, to say that this is a heavenly process, using the in capital letter, really to say, because this is to do with our own meaning or existence, because we are always in a process of return. You know, there are many philosophies about that, how our bodies return or not return or something like that. And, you know, there are a lot of philosophies about this, but of course, that's what Gibran is saying here, to say about our bodies, how our bodies return to earth and our souls return to heaven or to its creator. So this question here, it's a big question, which is the question of return. Are we going to return? you know, the whole idea of returning is here again, as I say, is symbolical. Yeah, that's why. So this poem, as I say, you can see again, you can see the allegory, you can see the symbolism, you can see the, as I said, the parable here, the fable meaning, the parable feel, and which is the real big symbolism. The big, as you can see, the whole poem is very symbolical in every sense. You know, the use of so many parts or so many questions to do with, you know, elements of nature. Yeah. Okay, let me see, is this the last one? No, yeah, I'll read this last, maybe I will read this again here. Song of Fortune, again here, about, again, I think, as I said, all his poems, all of his writings. I mean, he wrote again a very lovely book called The Prophet, really, called The Prophet, which is an amazing text. Really, many people read and maybe thought that this is a very huge influential book called The Prophet. Anyway, here this again is a symbolical poem. I will read it with you today. And the last one, I will leave it for you to read. And that's it about the whole course. Man and I are sweethearts. Man and I are sweethearts. He craves me and I long for him. But alas, between us has appeared a rival who brings us misery. She is cruel and demanding, possessing empty lure. Her name is subsistence. She follows wherever we go and watches like a sentinel, bringing restlessness to my lover. You know, here you can say, you know, fortune, who's saying here? Song of fortune? Is fortune here speaking? You know, fortune, luck. And sometimes we say this in Arabic, you know, we say this, يضحك له الحظ, يضحك له الحظ. Or we say sometimes, you know, تسمت له الدنيا, تبتسم الحياة له. We say that, isn't it? We say this in Arabic.
Yes, yeah. Personification.
Yeah, absolutely. And you can see here he said, man and I, you know, this I, who's speaking, is fortune, luck. We are sweethearts, he said. Man and I, man, notice man again, really means people, men and women. Men and women, really. But when he says here, he, again, could mean really al-insan. And sometimes we really, again, we mean here sometimes an-nas, it means sometimes men, not women. You know, even it's mentioned in the Quran so many times to mean an-nas, to mean men, really. Which is here, I think, in a way, here, man, and, you know, he means men, really. He craves me, and I long for him. You know, there is a love relationship between man and luck. But alas, between us has appeared a rival who brings us misery. So, but what separates me, luck or fortune and man, there is a rival which brings misery. What? Who is this? She is cruel and demanding, possessing empty lure. What is he talking about here? So this rival between man and fortune is a woman. So the woman stands between me and luck. Ahem, ahem. Is he saying that women bring bad luck? What? Wait a minute, let's see. She is cruel and demanding, possessing empty lure. Meaning women promise you something which is not there. Her name is subsistence. You know, she follows wherever we go and watches like a sentinel, bringing restlessness to my lover. I ask for my beloved in the forest, under the trees, by the lakes. I can't find him. For subsistence has stripped him to the clamorous city and placed him on the throne of quaking metal riches. I call for him with the voice of knowledge and the song of wisdom. He does not hearken. He does not listen. For subsistence has enticed him into the dungeon of selfishness where avarice dwells. Wow. I seek him in the field of contentment, but I am alone. For my rival has imprisoned him. I, the cave of gluttony and greed, and locked him there with painful chains of gold. I call to him at dawn when nature smiles, but he does not hear, for excess has laden his drugged eyes with sick slumber. I beguile him at eventide when silence rules and the flowers sleep, but he responds not, for his fear over what the morrow will bring shadows his thoughts. He yearns to love me, he asks for me in this own acts, but he will find me not except in God's acts. He seeks me in the edifices of glory which he has built upon the bones of others. He whispers to me from among his heaps of gold and silver, but he will find me only by coming to the house of simplicity, which God has built at the brink of the stream of affection. He desires to kiss me before his officers, he desires to kiss me before his coffers, but his lips will never touch mine except in the richness of the pure breeze. He asks me to share with him his fabulous wealth, but I will not forsake God's fortune. I will not cast off my cloak of beauty. He seeks the seed for medium. I seek only the medium of his heart. He bruises his heart in his narrow cell. I would enrich his heart with all my love. My beloved has learned how to shriek and cry for my enemy, substance. I would teach him how to shed tears of affection and mercy from the eyes of his soul, for all thanks and utter sighs of contentment through those tears. Man is my sweetheart. I want to belong to him. What is this? What do you think? I think this is a lovely poem, and again, absolutely, absolutely symbolical. Let me quickly again go through it. You know, again, it's really similar to the poems before. He is saying about the word substance. You know, he's saying substance. Notice when he said, between us has appeared a rival who brings us misery. She is cruel and demanding, possessing empty lure. Her name is substance. Substance. Now, he used the word she. Really, we thought it could be a woman. But he means substance here, means really, you know, objects, things. The thing that you are worried about, the world, the real world, the substance. You know, you worry about your clothing, your gold, your food, your whatever, anything to do with what you feel. And he used the word she to say you're always tempted by the present world, and you are forgetting everything else. So if you want fortune, you know, we have here to say that this substance, this thing will separate us, because you worry about empty things. Notice, empty, she said, substance, She follows wherever we go and watches like a sentinel, bringing restlessness to my lover. Because we are always running every day, running, running, running after worldly thing. Worldly thing. Really, he wants to say, as we say, worldly thing. Base thing. Our world thing. I ask for my beloved in the forest, under the trees, by the lakes. I can't find him. So notice here, he's, you know, the poem is giving the symbolism about the question of really where do you find the purity, the cleanliness, the absolute love, the absolute fortune, the absolute beauty. Going here is giving the symbolism of nature. I ask for my beloved in the forest, under the trees, by the lakes. I can't find him, for substance has spirited him to the clamorous city. In nature outside, you don't find anybody. Everybody came to the city. They want to be in the city to find, you know, substance, to find the world, the real world, the ugly world, cars, houses, restaurants, plays, you know, all these riches, all these riches. People want the world now. They don't worry. They don't want, you know, the beloved or the lovely, you know, clean nature. Substance has spirited them. You know, the world takes them away. The real world, the base world. As I said, we say, you know, in Arabic, if you like, الدنيا, الدنيوية, really, الدنيوية, if you like. That's what means here, really, substance. Has spirited him to the clamorous city, you know, the shining, absolutely rich city with lovely everything. You can find all the beauty, blah, 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 blah. But it's all substance, madda. It has nothing, no real spirituality in it. And placed him on the throne of quaking. Quaking or quaking, meaning shaky, not real, false riches. Notice metal riches. Metal riches. You know, everything which cracks, which quakes, which squeaks, which is empty. Oh, I call for him with the voice of knowledge and the song of wisdom. He does not hearken. I ask for my lover, for man, in books of knowledge, in wisdom, but I don't find anyone reading books of wisdom and books of knowledge or learning knowledge. Nobody listens. Nobody is there. He does not hearken. Why? Because substance had enticed him into the dungeon of selfishness. Selfishness, where avarice dwells. We don't find him there because he is running after his greed. Selfishness, egoism. Egoism, where only avarice. Avarice really means greed, al-jasha, al-jasha. Look at modern time today. Avarice, and that's the word here. Avarice dwells. يَعُمُّ الْجَشَعَ الْجَشَعَ يَعُمُّ. Really, supremely, this is the idea here. Isn't it? Avarice dwells. Dwells means completely controls everything. We are run by greed, 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 greed. Money, 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 money. Come on. Selfishness. Everybody wants his or hers. And that's it. I don't care about my neighbor. I don't care about my brother. I don't care about my parents. I want for myself. Wow. Horrible. I seek him in the field of contentment. Contentment, to be happy, to be satisfied. Al-rida wal-qana'a. Al-rida. Contentment, al-rida. And takuna radin. To be happy and to feel good. I seek him in the field of contentment, but I am alone. I couldn't find him. He's not here. Nobody is happy with what he has or she has. For my rival has imprisoned him. I, the cave of gluttony and greed, and locked him. I, the cave of gluttony and greed, and locked him there with painful chains of gold. Again, the same meaning, gluttony and greed, the same. He said it here. Nobody is happy with what they have. Nobody saying is, thank God we have what we have, and we are happy with what we have. Nobody is happy with what they have. They want more and more and more and more and more. You know, this is the idea, to be satisfied, to say, Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillah, I have something. You know, always say, yeah, I want more. I want more. You give me more. I deserve more. I want more. Come on. Greed and gluttony, as if we are imprisoned by chains of gold. You know, chains of gold. And that's it, you know. Isn't it? That's it. Al-qanatir al-muqantara min al-dhahabi wal-fidda, isn't it? Yeah, man is never happy. Man is never satisfied. My God. I call him at dawn, but nature smiles. But he does not hear. For excess has laden his drudged eyes with sick slumber. You know, again, I came in the dawn early in the morning, but nature was smiling, saying, he couldn't sleep. He's awake. God gave us the evenings to sleep and to relax. You know, to have to relax, to sleep, not to stay the whole night. You know, slumbering, sick slumber. To be awakened and playing on your mobile phones and your, you know, whatever you're doing, funny, ugly thing. Notice his drugged eyes, again, laden, as if your eyes are made of lead, means you are no more human. I call to him at dawn when nature smiles, but he does not hear. For excess has laden. You notice here, excess means always nagging and nagging and nagging and nagging and wanting more and more and more. You know, is excessively want, so he can't sleep. His eyes are swollen. Slumber. I beguile him at eventide when silence rules. Even I came. In the evening, just thinking that maybe I can catch him in a silent moment when silence, where evening where should be silence, but I couldn't find him. And the flowers sleep, but he responds not, for his fear over what the morrow will bring shadows his thoughts, because I couldn't find him quiet and happy, because he's busy thinking of tomorrow. Thinking of what's going to happen tomorrow. Don't. You know, this is really amazing, isn't it? Beguile means I come like stealing myself to see if I can find him in this silent moment. But like, you know, in the evening when flowers sleep, when everybody should be asleep. But this man, you know, he responds not because he's not there. Why? Because he's always busy thinking about tomorrow. His thoughts, you know, he's always busy with there. He yearns to love me. He asks for me in his own acts. Yeah, well, still you say, you know, I want fortune. He asks for me in his own acts. He will find me not except in God's acts. He seeks me in the edifices of his glory, which he has built upon the bones of others. You see? How do you expect to get good things, you know, when you build your own glory on people's bodies, meaning killing whatever. He whispers to me from among his heaps of gold and silver. You know, this is the al-qanatir al-muqantarati min al-dhahabi wal-fidda. Isn't it? Really? That's it. Heaps. Akwamin wa akwamin min al-dhahabi wal-fidda. Again, he whispers. Yahmusu ilayya. Hamasa ilayya min bayna akwami al-dhahabi wal-fidda. Wow. What? He will find me only by coming to the house of simplicity with God has built, which God has built at the brink of the stream of affection. He desires to kiss me before his coffers. You know, it's really an amazing poem. I really want you to think about this and to talk about the whole idea of symbolism about Gibran, because really Gibran here is giving us, as you can see, a lot of heavy, really strong questions. As you can see, all these poems really talk about that in every sense, in every way. Again, the last poem, please read that, because again, it's really lovely. And the final one, I will leave it for you to read, and you will be responsible for all these poems by Gibran. Okay? Yeah, Sarah is saying, yeah, about the flower, yeah, they call it Malikat al-Sabah, yeah, and Malikat al-Layl. Yeah, I don't know what it's called, but really this is a very good real flower we know, or a kind of rose or flower. Anyway, that's it, ladies and gentlemen. If you really have any question, you are welcome. I will answer any question if you want. The next meeting, I will leave it for discussions.